Yeah, I wasn't sure if it was, anybody saw that, probably not, right?
I think it's only available, I guess.
Is it?
I'm not sure.
Okay, it's a news channel, and they had five people on panel talking about three things. One was with students in the audience mostly, and they were talking about why the education system and the workforce requirements are not matching. So more or less what we were talking about, what skills are needed, and what the, and the students were saying, they come out and they have to relearn everything because what they learned in school wasn't connected to the workplace. And then they had the deans of two universities, I think, on there, I didn't check, I think, talking about how they want to change, but it's not that easy, et cetera, et cetera. Although one of them was from INSEAD, which is the business school out of France, and they have a branch in Singapore. And he was saying they're already making all the changes because the business schools are having to adapt to the new environment.
I heard there is a major changes in Finland.
Oh, Finland has made big changes.
Yeah, they discard all the subjects and just teach the kids to have some, so they don't have subjects like math, English, Chinese, no, they ban all the subjects and they just teach them how to problem solving skills and then see if they can relate to the real world, something like that. But I heard that people are opposing to that idea because, like for example for us, when we have to, when we were in high school, we all learned differentiation, but it is not that applicable to real life. Like for me, I don't know why I need to learn differentiation. I never used that after I graduated high school. But then some people, maybe they want to major in engineering, then maybe they really need those knowledge, I don't know. So maybe if you were not taught about those knowledge, then maybe your life chances would be limited.
Yeah, I think that's, the Finland is very different from everybody else, a very homogenous culture. And second, I think the school system, the teachers are extremely highly paid. And they got some of the best teachers, and the teachers can decide how to run the class. They don't have a, the outcomes are very much global outcomes rather than very narrow outcomes. And so Finland is, it's sort of like an outlier. They've always done differently, and they've done very well. The students come out doing really well on any metric that you choose, but it may be unique to their own culture and system. We actually hired two people from the Finland Department of Education. They work for us in Singapore. They're ex-retired people from there. They're very useful because they give you a different perspective, but it's probably tough to translate what they do on a global scale. I think it works in a very homogeneous population where teachers are extremely well regarded, they're very well paid, and they are seen as extremely important. But what was interesting was what we were talking yesterday sounds like it's beginning to be a very hot topic around the world, mostly because of the OECD report saying that what we're doing may not be good for what the students need in the future. Not enough. I wouldn't say good, not enough for the future. So let me turn it around and ask, what would you like to talk about, rather than me saying, because yesterday I sort of gave you the big picture overview. And the questions that came, some of the questions that keep coming up is motivation. How do you motivate students to remain engaged in school, in class, in universities, all those things. And that actually came up in the morning thing too. One of the faculty was saying the biggest problem is keeping students engaged and motivated and focused.
What motivated you to be so good, so great, and so knowledgeable?
I think I probably the way I was brought up. I was brought up in a household where reading and doing your own thing was always encouraged. My brother is the same way, my father was the same way, my kids are the same way. But it was the way we were brought up. But that's an easy way to say that we don't know. in many ways. Actually, one of the things is the schools that we run in Singapore at the medical school level, we're already picking people extremely interested, motivated, engaged. So less of a problem in the medical school level. But the medical school that is our counterpart in Singapore is similar to Hong Kong. They're taking medical students out of high school. We take medical students after you finish one degree. So all our students have finished one degree. One third of them are engineers. A third of them are coming from all kinds of fields, and a third are biology majors. Whereas the school that is at NUS takes people like Hong Kong U and others out of high school. The kids who come in there are often really not interested in medicine, but their parents push them to do medicine. And what you actually find is they graduate fine, but then they don't practice. They end up very unhappy with what they choose. And I think that's partly because, and that is true in the US, but getting less so, his parents are focused on traditional jobs, engineering, medicine, law, etc. But if you actually look at what's happening in the global marketplace, jobs are getting, first of all, you can do this, you can be in one part of the world and do your job in another part of the world. So yes, in this morning's conversation, the dean of INSEAD was saying he doesn't need faculty. He came right out and said he doesn't need faculty. And what he meant was faculty in the school. He said he can use faculty from anywhere, and therefore you can change how the dynamics of teaching happen. He's talking about business school in that particular case. But it will be an interesting thing across the whole landscape, because how many of you have seen, so you all know Alibaba, I assume you do because you're Hong Kong based, right? How many of you have actually used Alibaba? Probably not, because Alibaba is business to business. How many of you use Amazon? You have, right? You buy books, you buy things. How many of you use iTunes? Right? You use Spotify? iTunes. Uber is here in Hong Kong or not? Mm-hmm. Uber. Taxis.
Uber, yeah.
Yeah. Okay. And Airbnb is here, I know that. Airbnb is when you can rent your room to anybody you want. So all of them have one thing in common. They don't own anything. They're all marketplace, but they don't own anything. And they have become the most valued companies now in the world. And if you think of what they've done, they have changed the entire dynamics of how jobs, how you buy things, everything is changing, right? But fiber is a new thing that started last year, and I only used it early this year, first time. I don't know if we can pull it up. If you can get on Chrome and pull it up. So you actually can see where the world is going. And it's going very fast. This is the whole thing. And a lot of it is out of this part of the world. It's from China, India, Korea, and Japan. All are the ones driving it, but the people coming up with the business ideas are often US, Shanghai, Mumbai. They're the new, especially San Francisco, is the driver of a lot of these things. So if you look at what's going on, then you've got to ask yourself, what do we need to do to make our students be able to compete in this world? More important, what is it we need to do for ourselves as much as anything else? It's a very, very dynamic world. And let me see if I can show you. Actually, I was just showing this last Thursday, before I came here, last Wednesday, to the Minister of Trade for Singapore, because he didn't know. He was talking about getting people ready for the future skills, all those things. What I was telling him was future is already here. Future is here. And I told him that they're planning for jobs for Singaporeans 10 years from now. Okay, how do you get people ready? I told him, first of all, jobs are no longer physically linked to where you need to be. Right? So let me show you this. How many of you have you heard of this one? Huh? So this is anywhere, anybody in the world offering services. So remember, Amazon offers you products, right? Books, whatever. This one offers you services. You want somebody to write a paper for you. You get it ready, you tell your content, they will do it for you. So if you want, okay, creative writing. These are guys who write your essay, your research paper, your homework, your perfect article, 300 word articles. They make a marketing video on TV, blogs, etc.
So this one is for people who want to have their ideas written.
Yeah.
Even for homework.
Yeah. And services. You want a cover of a book, which is what I wanted. Okay. I go here. Let's say a book. Professional book cover. Okay, you just say, I want, and this person just to tell you how many orders are already in queue to get your book cover done. So you're writing a book, you don't need to anymore go to a book publisher. It's changing the entire marketplace dramatically. You don't need to go to a company, and guess what the price is? It all starts at $5. It's called Fiverr because everything is $5. You start at $5 and you can go to anything you want. Or if you say, I want whatever, you want to make proofreading, editing, they will do it for you. Book editor, proofreader, edit a chapter, write books, etc. Or if you say, I want logo designs, in fact, today, when I was emailing back, is we have a new website coming up, we need a logo. They pick 5 people on this one, they give each one an order, and you decide which of the 5 you want. Just think for a minute about how this changes learning. You want to study a subject. In fact, I think there is people who teach you the subject one-on-one, professionally, at a very low cost, global. And most of them are in Eastern Europe, they're in India, they're in China, and they're in Korea. But the student or the person who's buying the job could be anywhere in the world, US, Hong Kong, Singapore. So it means, in the past, we had needed to be physically located to get a job done, right? Just like you had to buy a product, you had to go to the neighboring store to buy it. That whole thing is changing. So this also means how you learn can change dramatically, which is what I think this guy is talking about, the NCR Dean was saying. He can get the best person to teach a topic from somewhere in the globe at the time you want it, when you want it, where you want it. So how do you, as a university, therefore, not worry about it, but take advantage of it? The key is taking advantage. They can never replace the real blend in a classroom. What you want is leverage that to blend in a classroom. This is something that if you don't never had a chance, then go take a look at it. It's the first of these kind of things coming. I'm sure you're going to find many more like these coming out. All of them are designed to make the marketplace of ideas come to your fingertips. So what they were also talking is exactly what we talked about yesterday, the learning in this world is no longer at all memorization. So what you really need are, I think 2 people emailed me last night from the library thing, asking about, one was, I think, somebody into art, and the other one was somebody who's doing a PhD in English. I don't know who it was. And they were, the last name is Chan, but I can't remember the first name. C-H-A-N. But what was interesting was what he wants to know is how, because if you think about it, in the old days, what you really wanted was somebody with technical skills. Now what you want is somebody who's really good in English, who can communicate very, very well, is going to be very valuable compared to 10 years ago when you're saying, why are you doing English? Or why are you doing Mandarin? Right? which is turning, it's flipping things on its head. Philosophy, by the way, is turning out to be one of the most important things that you can learn. Because it teaches you thinking. And it teaches you thinking in a way which is extremely important. And in fact, your booklet that you had in the front, the two things that you listed after learning, which was negotiation and persuasion, and decision making, will end up being some of the most important skills that universities can give. And in fact, again in this morning's program, I don't know if they saw yours or what, but they were saying decision sciences is going to be biggest, one of the biggest ones for growth. And again, I don't know if you offer courses in it, but if you don't, there's a book worth reading. It's called Predictably Irrational. And the reason for it is our brain is technically built to survive. When it is built to survive, it also is built to be irrational. We all think of ourselves as totally rational. We are not. We're only rational within the constraints of what we do. Okay, but we're actually predictable. That's the most important thing. Human beings are pretty predictable and predictably irrational. And the most important, there are about 50 such predictably irrational processes that are known from psychology. And out of those 50, many of them are base processes, meaning you can divide them up or originate them from 5 or 10 of them. I don't know who you plan to bring, but the person worth trying to bring is Dan Ariely. A-R-I-E-L-Y. Dan wrote the book Predictably Irrational. It's a bestseller. The other person is Richard Thaler, who's at University of Chicago, and he wrote a book called Nudge. Nudge is how to write or communicate in such a way that you make people do things that are good for them. And those of you who are into psychology will find it pretty fascinating. The people who did this work are economists, but they're basically using behavioral psychology to design economics. They all start with the work of two people. Amos Tversky was at Stanford, and then Daniel Kahneman, who worked with him and won the Nobel Prize for economics about 10 years ago. The only schools that are beginning to teach decision sciences in schools, secondary schools, is in Israel. The Israelis are using Kahneman to try to build a program to teach decision sciences very, very young. Reason behind it is that may end up being the most important part of what you can do for kids. Because problem solving, logic, how many schools teach logic here? You teach in high school?
There's not an entire subject like that, but maybe in some subject areas, part of it.
So you teach it in the university?
They don't,
in the university, we have courses.
Courses.
Yeah, elective courses.
But not required courses.
Not required courses.
And do you have courses in communication?
In my university, when I was undergrad, there is such courses.
Okay.
Also elective, not compulsory. Because everybody can enroll in that courses. It is not particularly one skill related to us.
Okay. And in schools you don't, you're not taught
communication?
No. You're not taught to debate or not taught
to debate, yes.
Yeah.
Okay. I think in Hong Kong many high school students have such activities, whether they join or not, it may be voluntary.
Okay. I think what you'll find is those skills are going to become very valuable because think of it, you can't put it on fiber. You can't suddenly make them be your communicator. You're going to have to figure out how to talk. So there are going to be some skills that if you just convert yourself to say, what skills can I outsource and what can I not outsource? Some of these you cannot outsource, you have to learn. And those are the ones that universities have figured out how to impart it as a core skill. You can't outsource choices. You can't outsource decision making. You can't outsource negotiation. You can't outsource communication. Those are, people call them soft skills, but they're actually going to become the key skills, I think, in the future. So, let me open it up because I don't think, you were here yesterday, right? I'm not sure.
Me?
No.
Yeah.
You were. So we're just trying to start the conversation from where we left it rather than go back on it. Is that okay?
Yeah.
So what if I leave it, open it up to you, you ask me whatever question you want, and I will engage in it. That could be a good way to take it for December. You had a course laid out yesterday, and the course, everyone has got a copy of that course, I think.
Yeah, the personal one.
So that course is probably a very typical course, I suspect, with lectures and tutorials. So if you had that course, and I suspect it's very similar to most university courses, how would you rearrange the course to ask yourself what, at the end of it, what should the person gain, which is your first set of goals, right? And the second set of goals is, how do you know whether they got it? Can you measure it? Third set of goals is, how do you make it achievable that they can reach it? How do you make it relevant to what they want to be? And how do you do it in the time frame that is set? Which is what we talked about as the first thing with anything, is being very clear what it is you want, the goal. Can you measure it? Is it achievable? Is it relevant? And can you set it up in a given time? You run the course, right?
So for this online, how would you evaluate it? Like, do you think this is a good online, or there is any improvement that can make it better?
Yeah, actually, when I looked at it, it's a very kind of problem. It's actually one of the things that you got here is you got the learning outcomes lined up very clearly. You can hear me, right? Can you hear me? Yeah. You got the learning outcomes very clearly identified. The question that is unclear is why should somebody choose to do this course, right? And when they finish this course, how is it going to be relevant to them? You actually have it in your initial outline of the course saying, it's more a question of making it explicit. You're making it very interesting, and I suspect anyone interested would come to it. But you also want to know, how do I make it useful? Is this course open to anybody, or is it only open to psychology majors?
Only to psychology and seniors.
Okay. So actually, that's what it looked like. You have it as a fourth level course, right? But this is the kind of course which could become like a core course, because in many ways, it gets you to thinking. This is into the, it goes between philosophy and psychology. It's in that interface area. And it's a kind of course where if you look at it, I actually think it's a great kind of course to make it like interactive, where you actually make people explore in how is it going to be relevant for them long term? What kind of thinking skills are you going to get out of them during the context of this course? It's not the actual content. The danger with these courses is if you try to get them to memorize, most of this will all be gone 3 months after they finish. Because a lot of what you had in the background, when I was looking at it, is very interesting, but it's very hard to know how you'll apply it. For example, let me put this one. Your second one is basic tools of logical argumentation. That could be a great one, where instead of a lecture, you actually give the content to them. They come back, and you actually ask them not just to focus on one argumentation, but turn it to apply to something else. You actually can turn it and make them use the same logic, argumentation, to a variety of things. So what you're therefore doing is turning from just to basically trying to remember something to figuring out how it could be applicable to lots of things. When I looked at it, you actually have got some great parts to it that can end up being very, very valuable teaching their core thinking skills. So when I looked at this course, I thought it's a great one to have, because you actually have got the, what I would call the elements to create thinking and to get them to focus on how it could be useful for them lifelong. And I mean, especially when you look at, you've got number two, you've got that I saw now, there were two, three things. Dennett, you have Dennett's thing, you've got Plato's analogy, all those things are extremely difficult thinking problems. But the question that you would ask is, what base skills do they have coming in that lets you know, are they capable or are they ready to get into it, which is where the testing comes. Oh, yesterday I didn't talk about it, but actually there's a very interesting phenomenon, which is if you do a pre-test before anybody comes in, and the pre-test, they don't need to know the subject at all, but a pre-test does something that is very unusual. It makes them think what you're going to focus on during the class. And when you do, anybody who gets a pre-test and then a post-test does better than those who never got a pre-test. So these are again randomized studies which have shown just doing a pre-test and then doing a post-test, the people who do the pre-test do better than the people who never did a pre-test, because it frames your mind to thinking about what should I learn during this whole thing.
But is the pre-test and post-test exactly the same?
No, they shouldn't be. They shouldn't be, but they should be obviously in the same topic. And they should be aimed, because you have hundreds of options of questions. But it's how you write those questions tells them, when I finish this, this is what I ought to be able to do. And therefore it helps them, it really sets the stage for their learning. Otherwise when you do complex topics, it's hard for them to know what is it they're going to know at the end of it. And this, by the way, even for simple topics. So this was done for medicine too. Just a pre-test and a post-test. People who get, half the people got a pre-test, the other half didn't get. The ones who got a pre-test do better. Just randomized. And you can do this. These are nice experiments to run in your own group. Give a pre-test to half your class and don't give a pre-test to the other half. Test it out. Figure out how to validate your own pre-test to see how good it is. You might have to keep refining it to make it better. But when I looked at this course, I thought this was a great kind of course, even early on. Not when they're ready to graduate or whatever. It's a very kind, because it introduces core thinking skills. And I would assume actually you have other things that you could do earlier on, which also goes after the core thinking skills. Because much of psychology ends up being taught like a subject where you're saying, these are the things that people have said, this is the theories, these are the terms that you gotta know, etc., etc. What you got to remember is most of the theories are theories. They're really not, there's a lot that we don't know. And therefore the introduction to it is to teach what we know, but to get them to explore what we don't know. And that's when you learn a lot. Right? So when I saw what you said, I thought this was a great kind of course, but I didn't think the lectures would be the right way to do it, because there's no reason why you can't give them, especially as a senior class or even a middle level class, you can give them all the content beforehand and say, come in, and what, this is the pre-test, this is what you want to try, and we'll explore how far you can connect to what you already know, that's elaboration, how far can you connect, how far can you use it to explain other things, and how could it be relevant to you. The two of you run it? No. You run it. Other points. This is the kind of course which can really be extremely useful for students. It may not be the kind of course they think is very important, but it sounds like a very obscure level course. The purpose is those thinking skills inside it.
And how about your skills course? Because this is a senior course. So if we try to teach some introductory level things, so sometimes some students may not be able to have the fundamental concepts yet. So they do not master those skills very well, the content wise. So would you still recommend them to do more exploration?
Essentially we also used to think the same way. Interestingly, some of the big systems are run there, if you want to call randomized studies to show how it works. If students expect to be spoon-fed when they come in, which is true in many Asian countries, they expect you to pre-digest and give them everything so they can memorize it and pass the exam. Then if you want to break that mindset where you're trying to teach them, there is a reason why you're learning this, and when you learn this, you will learn how to use it in the following way. Right? So that alone changes everything. If they don't expect to be spoon-fed. They will go learn. And if the club, they are, students are very effective in fitting what you want. So if you change what you want them to do, they will change it. But like anything else, like playing a game, the initial fundamental skills, you have to figure out how to give it to them quickly and effectively. So there's no point in teaching psychology if you can't get them at least a specific terminology of how they need to get into the idea behind it. Let me show you one other thing, which is the one from, I don't know if I'll be able to get into it, but I will try. So this is a high school teacher in a very tiny town, about 5,000 people, and he produces, he started teaching his high school students physics and biology. It's applicable to anything. But I will show you one or two of what he has done, and you can see. So this is what I was telling you, the US is now changing the exams. Once you change the exams, where you're testing thinking and no longer memory. School systems adapt, students adapt, everything adapts. But it's a big change. Let me show you what they do here. And I will show you with this. All of, before I play it, let me ask, all of you have done some biology, right? Everybody would have done that in high school. This is high school biology, but at a very advanced level. And I will see if it works. It does.
Hi, it's Mr. Anderson, and this is AP Biology Science Practice 1. What are science practices? Well, there are seven of them, and they're overarching skills and knowledge that you should have to do well as a scientist. Why is that important in AP Bio class? Well, if you're a teacher, if you're an AP Biology instructor, practices are skills and knowledge that you want to build in your students throughout the year. And if you're a student, these are the practices that you want to pick up. Because when you take the AP Biology test in the spring, they're going to ask you to apply the knowledge that you've picked up throughout the year using science practices. And so you want to understand what a model and what a visual representation is, because it's going to allow you to do better on the test, and it can also allow you to do better as a scientist. And this right here is a picture of DNA. So this is bacterial DNA under an electron microscope. And you might fool yourself into thinking that we're looking at the double helix, that we're looking at DNA, but that's not really what it is. If we zoom in as close as we can see, that's not what we see. In fact, the DNA is wrapped around histone proteins, which are wrapped around more DNA and more histone proteins. And we eventually get to something that looks like this. We call it a fiber of DNA, and that's what you're looking at in this picture. And so it's weird to think that we've never seen a double helix. We've never seen DNA at this level, especially at this level. And so how do we know that that's what it looks like? Through careful experimentation. Watson and Crick developed a model, and a model is going to allow us to understand how DNA works. It's a visual representation of what's going on inside the genetic material versus implants. And so this gives you an idea of what a model looks like and how it could be applied in an AP Biology class. But they're asking that you can do five things using models and visual representations. And so they first of all want you to be able to create models and representations. And so you can think of each of these questions, here's the first one, like a question you might experience on the AP Biology test in the spring. In other words, they're asking you to apply the knowledge that you've built using a science practice. In this case, you would have to build or create a model or representation. And so you could pause the video. I've got five of these, and you could try to do this, and then you could watch me explain it. And so pause the video now, and let me go through it. So we've got a hypothetical population of beetles.
So you're getting an idea how we approach. So if you take the same course, how would you put it in this kind of context? So at the end of the day, you're saying, why do I need to study this? That gets to motivation. Why is it useful for me long term? And what do I need to know when I finish it? By the way, this guy does it so well, we're using it in the medical school. Because I can't find faculty who can run it like he does. Which is, this is a small town with one guy. And he, I would say at this point, probably has got 300,000 kids in the US watching. Because he's better than the teacher in their school. So therefore, how do you take what he does and supplement what a teacher in the school can do? And that's what the school systems are beginning to think about. I actually showed this to the Minister for Education. He was amazed. First of all, very quickly you could realize that most students who finish biology cannot do these things because they never connected what they did with what they need to know, why they did it, and how you apply it. So in psychology in particular, it's got enormous implications from politics, to economics, to behavior, to decisions, to business, etc. How do you connect when you teach motivation to how you apply it later on in life, in work, etc.? So that gives you an example again. So this is a question which, if you just think about it, even if you don't have any background, you can come up with the answers. But it's a thinking skill, which he does.
There's wide variation in color, matching the range of coloration of the tree trunks. Create a graph that shows how the beetle population would change as a result of changes in the environment that darken the tree trunks. And so, what are some first things that I would look at? So we've got a beetle population, there's differences in color, but they're saying that we have a variety of different colors. And so we're going to represent that with a graph. We want to show the frequencies, but we're going to have a normal distribution. In other words, we could put beetle color here along the x-axis from light to dark, and we're going to get a normal distribution. In other words, some of the beetles are really light, some are really dark, but most of them are going to be in the middle. What are they then asking us to do? They want to show us evolution. They want to show us how they're changing as the bark becomes darker and darker. So what's going to happen? Well, as the bark becomes darker and darker, all of these lightly colored beetles are going to die because the birds are going to see them. They're going to show up. And so they're going to die on this side of that curve. And so this would be pre-evolution, and then this would be post.
So what it's actually doing is it takes your knowledge of a little bit of math, a little bit of normal distribution, a little bit of general principles, thinking, right? So if you're going to be light in a dark background, you're going to be eaten, and you put it together. That is what you want out of any learner. Why is it changing? Because they change the exam system. They change the questions. It doesn't test your memory at all. It's a pretty dramatic shift in 1 year that they did. The kids, the teachers in the schools had an enormous difficulty because the teachers themselves had never learned how to think that way. I'm just using this as an illustration of that. What do you think? I mean, do you just think of your own basic psychology classes. If you were to revamp it in this kind of mode, first you'll make it more interesting. Second, I think people will engage more. And third, I think they will learn to figure out how to apply it, because you'll actually turn it around and ask, say if it's a class, I'll say, what do you want to be? And then ask, how, if you learn this, how would you be able to use it to your advantage? You open the class to get them to give you, ask the questions, each other, figure out a way where it will be useful, and then figure out how to take what they're just learning and apply it. Once they do that, they're, number one, they're going to remember it a very long time. And number two, it's going to be useful. Number three, it leads to motivation, which is a cycle that you want. But it's a sea change in how you approach learning, because it's so different from the transmission learning that we normally do. What I'm doing now is still transmission learning, but I'm trying to engage you like he's doing. Have any of you seen this before? It's interesting. I started to use these things to illustrate even for when we started at our own faculty, this was not there. This all last 3-4 years coming. I actually don't know how he produces it, because he produces it far better than I can do, even though I have more resources than he has. And by the way, he doesn't teach biology alone, which tells you how these guys are becoming. Everyone says chemistry is memory, right? And biology is memory. I think he will do these in ways in which you will remember a long time.
Hi, it's Paul Anderson, and this is video one in the Chemistry Essentials series. The history of chemistry goes way back to the alchemists. The alchemists searched for what was called the Philosopher's Stone. It was this magical stone that they thought could turn something like lead.
What do you see right on bottom? The advertisement is fiber. I'm going to tell you, I'm so amazed how fast it's teaching. It makes, and I keep telling my faculty, we're all going to get irrelevant if we don't figure out a way to adapt fast enough. It's the same as that beetle on the bark. We're there to be eaten by a world which is changing extremely fast. By the way, a lot of it is out of China. These are young guys out of China, young guys out of Mumbai. I met a few, San Francisco and Israel, where a lot of this is happening. It's hungry. They're very hungry, and they see a way to completely change the world. It isn't coming out of Singapore. And I don't think it's coming out of Hong Kong. I think the Hong Kong, Singapore are all real estate built markets. They've not yet realized that that's fixed markets and these are mobile markets. I give a separate presentation where I talk about mobility in the future, which is more fun. But to me, you're the group that's going to change the world, not me. I'm like the beetle. I'm going to be eaten at some point. But hopefully, it makes you think of what do you need to teach your students to stay. They like this kind of stuff, by the way. They engage very fast. I've noticed when you put it to them, and it's no longer testing them on memory. Right now, you're driving them based on your tests, and your tests. Traditionally, like the Cambridge, I don't know what you do, O-level, A-level kind of stuff, like Cambridge, is just dramatically bad. And I told this to the UK Minister of Education, that they are doing a disservice. But it's very hard for them to change. That's why all these changes are coming from the outside. The outside is disrupting. I mean, you just look at the UK labor market, you can see the US labor market, they're all struggling. Because these are guys coming from the outside and disrupting it. And they're all young guys. And as today's presentation in the CNA thing was that a lot of them don't have formal education. They all seem to have quit somewhere in the first year of college and have gone up to start these things. But somewhere I think they are more aware of what's happening. They're changing things. But to me, you only have 4 programs, right? Inside. The school business, 4 big ones from what I was told. Business psychology.
Actually, not only for that.
Yeah.
We have 10 departments. Chinese, English, business, finance, general, some sociology, social work.
Almost all the topics you have are the topics that kids need to learn. They're not the technical, simple. You're not a professional school. You're much more into non-professional, core learning. I actually was impressed with what you put together is what you want to focus on. They're the right things. But I think it's not just what you want to focus on, but it's how you focus. That's where you can do a big, big, big jump. I suspect you don't have really any rivals in Hong Kong. So if you were to do more radical things that students and others want, you probably do extraordinary. That would be my guess.
So somehow for the university, so like here, so it's not a science school, so basically, so usually we focus on arts and humanities most of the time. So do you think, so because we have a lot of illustrations on how we can apply these kind of thinking in science, because there are a lot of logical. Of course, I think arts and humanities have the other kind of logic. try that, for example, in high school, teaching other subjects like blockers or...
Like what?
Like languages, humanities.
Actually, language is the one of the best ones for these things. And the reason for it is, think of what language is. Language is communication. Communication means, what does the other person interpret what you said, right? And what does that mean? Which actually means the psychology of language. So if you really want to look at, and I don't know Mandarin at all, it's like no idea, but if you think about English, which is the main language for communication, if you look at students coming out today versus students who graduated 30, 40 years ago, there is a difference, right? There is a difference because the language they use now, they never got emphasized, because they never got emphasized enough in the schools. Okay? They were taught to write in a very flat way. And the flatness takes up the richness of communication. And the richness of communication is what people really, really want. Why do you buy something that is desirable? It's the language that attracts you. It's the visuals that attracts you. It's the sound that attracts you. Can you do it for schools? Yes, they're beginning to do it. And again, I've only seen experiments. I've never seen large-scale application, probably because the exams don't reflect it.
Yeah, so that's the difficult part. So you said, it actually, it's a bit hard for us to assess.
Very hard.
Thinking, communication, you know, subjects like humanities.
No, actually, arts and humanities, there are people and building methods to do that. But they're tougher, much tougher than this thing. But for the ones that you've chosen, you actually could do a lot more, I suspect. Psychology in particular is very much a blend of this with communication. Businesses. Business schools are already moving this way, because if you're going to a master's in business administration, you want something out of it. The person is paying money, and they vote with their feet what they want. So you're beginning to see executive education already changing. From executive education, you will see evening schools change and then day schools change.
Sometimes I think, yeah, for psychology, it is easier to make the link between the theory and the real world, the application part. But
you know what, I've come closer to that site, so it works.
Yes,
please. Why don't I do it?
Yes, professor. See, at the middle. You are the center of the world.
I'm not the center of the world. That's not a good thing.
Okay, here is China, Zhongguo. Yes, this is much better.
Okay. So I think it's best to think. In fact, it was quite interesting. Yesterday I was telling you a guide on the sign, Sage of the Stage. They were using the exact same language this morning. They did not exactly guide on the site, but they kept saying faculty should be guides.
I mean, sometimes, for example, for my courses, I do different courses, and for each of my courses, I have some application product, like, for example, health psychology. I asked them to pick up a leaflet in a hospital and see if that was a good leaflet, and what to use some theories to explain how it can be improved, which part is using which theory, something like that. But then I think many of the times, actually, for university students that I encounter, actually, language is a big problem, because sometimes they have the idea, but they cannot express well, or they cannot understand well, and sometimes it really hinders how they can learn. Like, yeah, and sometimes as a teacher, I'm not sure what's my role, because I'm not good at teaching them languages, and I'm not sure how to improve it. Yeah.
So yesterday I said in the very first part on the five skills, literacy and numeracy, if you don't have good levels of that, everything else is a problem. And this is turning out to be quite true, that people come out of school systems and their literacy levels are not very good. The reason is they focus too much on passing some exam. The teachers told them, write it this way and you'll be graded right. They never learned to think what they were communicating. And the literacy levels that the OECD has been testing is beginning to show that literacy levels are not good. So you're right, that a lot of this thing, by the time you get them, it's harder to change. But it's still doable.
I'm not sure what my role is in helping them, because I cannot teach them the
language.
Each of them, it is just impossible for a 120 student class. I can't get them to come to me one by one. And the language, the books, everything is written in English. And if they cannot understand the materials there, even though in lecture I can use Chinese to communicate with them, still they, when they get back to revision or anything, the language is the main problem, and I'm not sure how I can help them with that.
So what do the rest of you think? It's a problem particularly, I suspect, in Hong Kong. It's a really big problem in Japan. I was in Japan just about 2 months ago for their Prime Minister's office, is trying to tackle this problem. Because Japan is so heavily focused on their own language. But the problem is not the language alone, they just, even in Japanese, they can't convey very clear. Because they said they have prepared themselves to do well, because heavily exam-oriented society. Doing well on those Japanese exams, which is remembering the characters, writing them in a way, and communicating them in very, essentially very stilted way. But it doesn't work for this rapid changing communication. On the other hand, what they've done is built their own Facebook emoji communication systems. I don't know how many of you use emojis, but that's becoming its own language. So it's a different language that's picking in, disconnected from anything that a school is teaching. And actually disconnected from faculty, because I mean, no matter how much I try, I don't know the emoji language, because it looks like everybody uses slightly, and it actually is interesting, Android versus iPhone is different. So I didn't know. I was trying it out with my son, and I figured out I couldn't, you had to be on the same system to get the same characters across, because they have different meanings attached to it. But what you're saying is correct, and it is actually the problem the OECD is finding out. That we have to figure out a way to start fixing this early on in the school systems to move away from simple literacy assessment. They call them 5 levels of literacy, and most schools and universities don't seem to get beyond the 3rd level. 3rd level means they know the basics. It's enough for you to get along most things in daily life, but it doesn't get you to advance very far. But you're exactly right. I just don't know what the answer is in the Hong Kong context. You're coming from the school system, so maybe you know. My brother, speak up a little bit. I'm not sure they can.
I'm coming from the secondary school, and we also have the same problem. Students cannot express themselves well, whether it is in English or in Chinese. And I think that the primary student need to learn better. Because I heard from someone that learning language should be should take place at a younger stage. Yes. So I think it is not, even the secondary school student, if we try to teach them language, it will be quite hard. Do you agree?
I agree, but we don't have a choice. We have to figure out a way to, in fact, when they come to med school, we're finding about 5-6% of them have some trouble with that. We actually focus on, we try to get them tutored in language. Because we know if they don't get language communication right, they're never going to be good doctors. So we use actors. We actually use actors over and over and over again. Interestingly, I've got to say, 10 years ago, students coming from mainland China had a lot more language difficulty than now. So I don't know what's happening, but their English, many of them speak English with an American accent, and they're very fluent. Somewhere somebody has told them the rewards come from learning language. It's actually striking the PhD students who used to come 10 years ago to now, how good the language is. They're far better than the Japanese that we get. It's not that they're smarter. I think they've figured out that their value in the marketplace increases if you learn how to communicate.
the students from China are quite hardworking. They learn up to the night. They have night lessons during the night.
Yeah, they have like longer working hours than adults do. Like 9 in the morning and then 7 at night. They keep working and working and working on the past papers nonstop.
And I think that is the motivation point. They're more hungry. They're more hungry. And actually, these are things which are very tough at a societal level. What to do? Singapore's having some of the same issues. They actually allow Chinese students from mainland China to come into the university systems, and those students are performing really well. And that's affecting morale inside